Hello students, welcome to Zoology classroom. In today's class, we are going to discuss about origin and salient features of black hole Fermi. So before entering into the topic, let us have a look at the classification of phylum Chordata. So the phylum Chordata is divided into three subphyla. One is Urochordata, second one is Cephalochordata, and third one is Vertebrata. Vertebrata is also called as craniata. Why? Because the organisms that have placed under this subphylum, they are possessing vertebrae in their backbone. So that as they are possessing vertebrae, the name has given, this vertebrata name has assigned to this group of animals. And all these organisms, they also possess cranium, which is a skull-like structure, which is present in the head region. In this cranium only, brain will be safely placed in this cranium. So, as they are possessing this cranium, they also assigned the name craniata. Coming to these two organisms, Urochordata, these two subphyla, Urochordata and Cephalochordata, they do not possess any vertebrae in them, and they also do not possess this crania also. So that these two groups collectively are called as acraniata. Or these two groups have placed under a these two subphyla have placed under a group called acrania. So we are not bothered about this acrania. Now in this class, we are very, very important about this vertebrata only. So again, this vertebrata are the animals which are possessing vertebrae and cranium or skull. They have classified into two divisions. One is anatha and second one is natostomata. In anatha, we have already discussed it about this in previous class. Ashakodermi and cyclostomata, two classes are there. Ashakodermi organisms are extinct now, they are not living, and cyclostomes are living now. So they do not possess a lower jaw or jaws, so that they are called as jawless fishes. Actually, they are not true fishes. They look like fish in appearance, so they are called as jawless fishes. Coming to the second division, natostomata, these are the true fishes. These are possessing jaws in their skull, so they are assigned this term called as natostomata. So in natostomata, two superclasses are there. One is Pisces or Pisces, and second superclass is Tetrapoda. In Pisces, different classes of fishes have placed in superclass Pisces. So in this, we have Placodermi, Chondrichthys, and Osteichthys. Earlier, Placodermi was the single class for extinct fishes with jaws. But now this Placodermi is split into two classes. One is Placodermi and another one is Acanthodi. So in today's class, we will be confined to this Placodermi class, how these Placodermi fishes originated from the previous fishes, and what are the salient features of these Placodermi fishes. So these details will be discussed in this class. So in the previous class, we have seen how from which organisms the Ashakodermi organisms have originated. We have seen that these Ashakodermi originated from either Urochordates or Cephalochordates. So their larva, the larva of Urochordata or Cephalochordata, they did not undergo this metamorphosis. So without undergoing metamorphosis thing, and they have gave rise to a new group of organisms called as Ashakodermi. So coming to this Urochordates and Cephalochordates, the origin of these Urochordates and Cephalochordates have been discussed in previous classes. Even though, let us have talk about the origin of these organisms for a second. So the Urochordates, they originated from some larvae of echinodermate. So echinodermate, auricularia larvae. So these auricularia larvae are dolichialaria larvae. They have gave rise to this Urochordates, and Urochordates, some of the Urochordates without undergoing metamorphosis, they have given rise to these Ostracodermians. And as we have seen in the previous class, Ostracodermians, the ancestors of Ostracodermians are Picaia and Haikyuctis. So now let us discuss about the origin and salient features of Placodermy in detail now. So the taxonomy or classification of Placodermy is like this. They come under domain Eukarya, kingdom Animalia, phylum Cardata, subphylum Vertebrata, and division are clade Eunathostomata and class Placodermy. So what are the features of these Placodermians? Let us have an introduction about these organisms. So during the Silurian period, the Ostracoderms, they were disappearing, or they were on the verge of extinction during the Silurian era. So these Ostracoderms, when they were disappearing, the more efficient new group of organisms appeared on this planet Earth, and they had jaws. So the first jawed fishes appeared when these Ostracodermians were disappearing from planet Earth. Earlier, these organisms, jawed fishes, distinct jawed fishes, they grouped under single category, that is Placodermy only. But now this all these extinct Placodermians have split into two separate classes. One is Placodermy and other one is Acanthodi. So we will discuss about the details of Acanthodi in next video. So according to taxonomist opinion, these two classes, okay, these Acanthodi and Placodermy, these two classes are placed lower to Condictis fishes in the evolutionary tree. And these Placodermians, they belong to quite different in several respects, are considered closer to the cartilaginous fishes and treated as a Nathostomata. So these Placodermians are regarded as the first true fishes appeared on the planet Earth. And the Placodermy name originated from two Greek words, Placos and Derma. Placos means a flat plate-like thing, and Derma means skin. So as their skin is possessing a plate-like structures on their skin, so they got this name Placodermy. And they were having jaws, and they were having heavily armored structures like these flat plate-like structures on their skin. And they're also having the spiny fins like these cartilaginous fishes. The present-day cartilaginous fishes are having the spiny fins. Likewise, these Placodermians are also possessing the spiny fins. And they possess the paired fins. In the earlier group Ostracodermians, we have not seen the paired fins. But these organisms, they are possessing paired fins. So the major change that occurred in these Placodermians is the origin of jaw. So for the first time in the animal kingdoms, jaws have been developed in Placodermians only. So these are the first jawed fishes. So how the first jaws came into existence, or how the first jaws originated in these organisms? So we don't know how exactly this thing happened, but scientists are predicting one thing that is explained in this slide. So we can see that in this slide, in this first diagram, so different types of gill arches will be there in the embryological development of the vertebrates. And in adult stage also, they will have some gill arches. So these gill arches, they will give support to the gills of these organisms. We know that gill slits are a very important recognizing feature of the chordates. So these gills are having a support, and that support is nothing but these gill arches. So several pairs of gill arches will be present in the embryological development of all the vertebrates. So earlier these gill arches were remained in gill arches shape only, but in these Placodermians for the first time, the first two pairs of gill arches, they have got modified. The first pair, see, in this second diagram and third and fourth diagram, we can see the development or metamorphosis or change in the shape of these first pair of these gill arches. So the first pair of gill arches, they have modified and they took the shape of jaws. And second pair, they have modified, they also modified and they also took the shape of a hyoid apparatus. So this hyoid apparatus also gives support to this jaws. So in this way, the first pair of gill arches, they have changed, they have converted into JAS. So in this way, just by modifying the first pair of gill arches, the JAS appeared in these organisms. So the appearance of JAS led to the origin of a new group. That new group now is called as Placodermi. So why this JAS developed in these organisms? So in the evolutionary point of view, we know that if a new character, if a new trait is selected, if a new character or if a new trait is selected by the nature, that must have a benefit to that organism. So if the new character is not having any benefit, it is not useful in any way, then that trait will not be selected by the nature. So as the JAS are originated and these JAS have been selected by the nature and these JAS are continuing in these organisms, and the evolution of JAS went further, and we know that how the JAS are there in the present organisms, some arctic groups like this what thecodontians like mammals and some crocodilians are also. So JAS are very powerful in these thecodontian organisms, thecodont teeth organisms like this what crocodiles group, crocodilia and mammals. So right from the beginning of this Placodermi, JAS have been selected and they further evolved into a very, very bigger and powerful structures in these organisms. So what are the uses of these JAS in the beginning when they were formed in the Placodermi organisms? So now we know that JAS are very useful for us in biting the food, grinding the food or eating the food. But the first use or first advantage of these JAS for these Placodermians is not related to feeding, but it is related to the respiration capacity. So the JAS, they help these organisms to increase their respiration efficiency. So we know that all these organisms, they are respiring through their gills. So the gills need to have the water supply, continuous water supply to them. Otherwise, they will not receive oxygen and they cannot have this respiration efficiency. So to increase this respiration efficiency, the appearance of JAS, the new structures, of these JAS help these organisms to respire efficiently. So as these JAS are used as buckle pumps in these organisms, JAS help to pump more water into these onto these gills so that the animals were able to get more water supply with the help of these buckle pumps. And this buckle cavity was used as a pump to pump more water onto these gills with the help of JAS only. So by opening and closing the mouth with the help of these JAS, the animals, these Placodermi fishes, were able to get more water onto these gills. Thus, they were able to receive more oxygen into their bloodstream. So like this, these organisms, they got the benefits of this JAS, not in terms of feeding, but in terms of respiration efficiency. So over evolutionary time, what happened? The JAS have been used for various other purposes, like in feeding. And this has become very important function in the vertebrates in the later course of time. So many teleost fishes have substantially modified their jaws for suction feeding and jaw protrusion also. So the jaws of these animals, they can protrude from out from their mouth. That means they can send their jaws to somewhat out of their mouth, and they can grab the prey organisms also, or their feed organisms also. So in this way, in teleost fishes, the jaws have been modified in feeding function. But in the beginning, or in the Placodermi fishes, jaws were useful in increasing respiration efficiency, but not in helping in feeding activity. So how the Placodermians originated? So Placodermi fishes, now they are extinct. Okay, so we cannot see them. They appeared about 430 million years ago in the Middle Silurian period, and they disappeared from the planet Earth around 378 million years ago during Devonian extinction event. So during the Devonian period, a major extinction event occurred. So at that time, a lot of organisms, animals, plants were completely disappeared from planet Earth. During that extinction event, these Placodermians are also extincted and disappeared from planet Earth. So some survived and made a slight recovery in diversity during a Faminian epoch before dying out entirely at the close of the Devonian era 360 million years ago. So at this 378 million years ago, Devonian extinction took place. So at this time, most of the Placodermians were extinct, but some of them, they got opportunity to survive. But these things are also, they came to extinct completely around 360 million years ago during the close of the Devonian period. So these Placodermians, they are the ancestors to modern Gnathostome vertebrates. So in one sense, they are also ancestors to human beings also, as we are also Gnathostomes. So these organisms, they were having their heads and thorax were covered with massive and ornamental armored plates. So that's why only they got this name Placodermy. And rest of the body was scaled or naked. So mostly scales were confined to head and thorax regions. The remaining abdomen region, it was having some scales, or in some cases, it was naked also, depending on the species. And this armor shield was articulated with the head, armor hinged to the thoracic armor. So this is a big difference between this Placodermians and Ostracodermians. So Ostracodermians are also, they are also having these armored plates. But the armored plates were completely covering the body of those Ostracodermians. And one more thing is that these Ostracodermy plates, the Ostracodermians, they were having completely fused plates on their body, so that they were not like hinges. So that means these armored plates did not move in any direction. But as these Placodermians are possessing hinged armored plates, especially the armored plates of the head are articulated with the hinge joints with this thoracic plate, so that they can move their head from up to down positions and sideways also. But these Ostracodermians were not able to move their head. Why? Because the plates are tightly attached to the plates of the thoracic region. So they were not able to move their heads. But whereas these Placodermians, they are having a hinged joints with these thoracic plates of the head plates, from this head plate, so that they were able to join, they were able to move their heads to some extent, up and down positions and sideways also. So, and it is believed that some primitive ostracoderms were the probable ancestors of these Placodermians. But however, no fossils have been recovered or collected by the scientists to support this opinion. So just they are predicting, so we cannot clearly say that what is the ancestor of this Placodermians. Just a prediction is made by the scientists that some of the primitive ostracoderms are ancestors to this Placodermians, but a connecting link is not recovered or collected by the scientists so far. But in next coming years, we may recover them. So, and coming to the salient features of these Placodermians, so they are regarded as the first true fishes, and they were having these plate skin plates on their body, so that they are also called as plate skinned fishes. And the plates are they are like bony armor, just like that of Ostracoderms also. So they were mostly the bottom dwellers and lived in the they lived on invertebrates like their Nathan and counterparts are ancestors. So like Ostracoderms also, like Ostracoderms, these Placodermians are also, they were feeding on some invertebrate organisms. And they were closer to cartilaginous fishes. The presently cartilaginous fishes are chondrichthyes fishes are there. So they are very close to the chondrichthyes fishes than osteichthyes fishes. The shape and size of these organisms varies a lot. So from small size to larger size organisms are present. So say for example, some organisms were a few centimeters longer, whereas the biggest Placoderm measures up to 10 meters length, that is Dunkelosteus. So Dunkelosteus is an organism, a placoderm that measures up to 10 meters in length. So the length of this body varies from few centimeters to 10 centimeters, and the shape of this body also somewhat it is a dorsoventrally flattened body. So these dorsoventrally flattened bodies are an adaptation to bottom living lifestyle. So body was divisible into head, trunk and tail. The head and trunk were covered with bony shields, but the tail region and abdomen region was not mostly, it remained mostly naked in many species. In few forms, tail also had some thin scale coverings. So in this slide, this is a fossil collected by scientists. This is the fossil of Dunkelosteus. So this Dunkelosteus only, it measures up to 10 meters high. So in this thing, we can see that these are the plates or armored plates of the head region, and this is the these are the armored plates of the thoracic region. So here the head region armored plates are joined with this thoracic plates with a hinge joint. So hinge joint is allows these head to move up and down position, so that the heads can be moved up and down and to somewhat sideways also. This feature was not seen in Ostracodermians. And they had paired, paired fins. Fins were in pairs, and the tail was a heterocercal type of fin. Tail was having heterocercal type of fin, and jaw suspensions were autostylic or aphytohyoidean type of jaw suspensions or jaw joints were there. Palatoquadrate and mandibular bones remained unossified, so they were not ossified, and they fused rigidly to head shield to the inner part of the cranium. And the hyoid arch was relatively unspecialized and did not participate in jaw suspension. In present day vertebrates, the hyoid arch participates in the jaw suspension or jaw joint. So the hyoid arch second gill arch forms into this hyoid arch. This hyoid arch forms the jaw suspension in present organisms, vertebrates, but in these placoderms, it did not participate in jaw suspension formation. And jaw consists of bony plates formed by modification of dermal bones lining the jaw cartilage. So similar plates on palatoquadrate bone. Palatoquadrate bone is a bone in the jaw, lower jaw, upper jaw bone. So, in this similar plates were also present on palatoquadrate. Probably these plates were assisted them in crushing the shelled mollusks and arthropods. So, scientists are opinion that this palatoquadrate, as it is having a bony plate on it, this palatoquadrate bone, upper jaw bone, helped them to crush the shells of these mollusks and arthropods. And they developed an internal ear with semicircular canals also. So spiracle also was present present on their heads, and this spiracle is probably maybe a typical gill slit between the mandibular and hyoidean arches. And the fins in general were similar to those of the early shark fishes. And these fishes, these fins were represented by a pair of pectoral fins and a pair of pelvic fins. And these fins are also the pectoral fins were large, having the large spines, pectoral spines, and the spines were attached to the bony plates on the trunk. And males had pelvic claspers also. So this claspers feature is also seen in Chondrichthyes fishes, present day Chondrichthyes fishes also. That's why these placodermians are thought to be very close relatives of present day Chondrichthyes group. And in this thing, so up to this thing only you are required to write in the examination. So from this oddest thing and the thing that I am going to explain later is not required in examination point of view. So you need not to worry about this later part of this thing, of this lesson. So these orders are the placodermy, class placodermy is classified into these several orders: Arthrodida, Antiarchy, Rhinanida, and Petalicida, and Acanthothoraci, and Tychodontida. Arthrodirans, this Dunkel HTS belong to Arthrodira order. So they are the best known placoderms. So heavy dermal shields were covering this head region and trunk region also. So these head shields and trunk shields, they were meeting with a movable joint or hinge joint. So remainder of the body covered with smaller bony scales, or in some fishes it was naked also. Two pairs of upper jaw tooth plates was present in this Arthrodirans. And antiarchy, so Bothriolepis is example for this antiarchy order. So they are the small placoderms, maximum they'll reach the length of 15 to 20 feet, but majority were very small organisms. So they exhibit atypical pectoral fins and dorsal eyes were present in these organisms. So they have flattened and ventral surface, and they suggested to be bottom feeders as they were possessing this flat ventral surface. And they have eyes on top of their heads. So all the bottom dwellers, usually they will have eyes on their top of their body or on the dorsal surface of their body. And pectoral fins are enclosed in bony appendages. Another order is Renanida. So the character Renanida, example for this is Renanida is a Gemmundina species. So these Renanidans were having the reduction, they were showing the reduction in the thoracic armor. So only major scales were present on the head region, and there was a reduction in the scales on the thoracic region. Body was covered by a small tessera or small square-like stones. So you can see in this diagram also small stone-like structures are seen. So these are called as tessera. And dorsoventrally flattened, they were in dorsoventrally flattened shape. So and pectoral fins were enlarged. And they were known in marine environments. So they were living in marine environments. And they are very similar in present day, in shape in, with present day ray-like fishes. So present ray fishes also, torpedo fish we see that. So torpedo also will be similar in shape with these Renanidans. And they are also benthic in lifestyle, bottom dwellers in other words. Next order is Petalictida. So they are also closely related to Arthrodires, and they rarely exceed a meter. So the size of these organisms was below 1 meter, and they were living in freshwater bodies and bottom dwellers. So they are having a dorsoventrally flattened bodies. Unlike Arthrodires, they are bottom feeding fish. So Arthrodires are not bottom dwellers. They were active swimmers, Arthrodires, but these Petalictidians were bottom dwellers. So they are having a flat body, dorsoventrally flattened body. Trunk is very short and long, and spine-like plates were present on their body. So nostrils and anterior part of the head shield around the orbits were covered with a number of tiny scales, as is the long trunk also covered with these scales. Next order is Acanthothoraci. So these Acanthothoracians, they were having a stout spine, they were having a stout spine emanating from the median dorsal plate. So they were not dorsoventrally flattened in shape. Some Acanthothoracians are similar to rays, expanded pectoral fins and flattened appearance was present in these organisms. So long head shields were present, and trunk is very shortened in length. So long shields were present on the region. And with eyes and nails pointing upwards, so eyes and nails were present on the upward direction, suggesting a bottom dweller. So next order is Pictodontida. These Pictodontinans, they were having elongated bodies, and their tail was like a whip-like in shape. The head is reduced in these organisms. Thoracic armor was also reduced, and they exhibit sexual dimorphism. Both male and females were looking differently. Males of one Pictodontida, example is Frankfurt Opus, we can see in this slide. It is having a Casper's similar to present the sharks. So with this, this topic is over. We will meet with other topic in next lesson.